It's actually quite a difficult thing to describe because there's so much within it, but I'll try and do it as quickly as I can. So there's a character called Eugene. So he's in the 80s in America, and he's a young kid there who every time he goes to sleep, he has these dreams of like distant worlds and galaxies and superheroes and villains. And he feels inspired to try and turn them into a comic book. He loves comic books and wants to sketch them and write his own comic based on those ideas. And just by chance, obviously, as often the case with these things, a movie company at the same time wants to create a superhero movie in the 80s and cast a German action star as a superhero, and he wins a competition and his comic book gets turned into the movie. Now, as this is going on, as these things often happen, the superheroes that he dreams of may actually be real and may end up on the film set to cause some havoc. And it's about finding the sort of hero within, and Eugene's got to step up and save the world from the evil Lord Hector.
Very good. You did
Thank
very
you,
well
mate.
With that.
Yeah, there we go.
I'm in.
I am currently the producer of Eugenius, one of the producers, one of three. I was introduced to the project about 3 years ago, it felt like now, when Chris and Ben here approached me about playing a character and recording a concept of a couple of the songs, which got me totally enthused and hooked on the project. And you know, I wanted to make sure we saw it on the stage and could share it with, you know, a much wider audience. If you hear one of the songs, and you can do that because there are some songs you can stream from all of the popular online services, Spotify, iTunes, etc. Have a listen, and immediately you kind of, I mean, the songs, they tell such stories. They paint pictures in your head and remind you of the 80s. And they're very catchy, and so as soon as I heard the songs, I met Ben and Chris here. I was just taken in with their kind of enthusiasm and their kind of vision for putting this on stage, and I wanted to be a part of it in whatever capacity they would have me. So, you know, whether it was playing a character in the show or being more on the creative side, and that's what I'm involved with as far as the other Palace run goes. You know, I'll be more on the producing creative side of things there. You know, I've enjoyed playing Hector, and I will play Hector again if they'll have me in the future, because he's a fabulous villain.
As we were writing the show, we had certain people in mind while we were writing the particular parts. Not saying that you're an evil villain in real life, but you know, we were sort of channeling everything to do with Warwick and all of the sort of previous, you know, amazing films that he's done where he does play sort of villainous characters. Mm. And you know, at that stage, we didn't have any clue that Warwick would even want to be involved acting in it or be on the concept album or anything, really. So we were sort of just taking a punt that maybe he'd like to join in.
Yeah.
So we contacted him through some friends and sort of were hoping and praying with all our fingers crossed that he would like to get involved, and obviously, you know, not just getting involved now, but obviously producing it and taking it to the next level. So we're very grateful.
I always remember the first time we met Warwick to work on the project. I turned up at Ben's house before Warwick got there and realised I was wearing a Star Wars t-shirt. And Ben was like, he's just going to think you're a fanboy. I wrote inviting him round. So I was
never
like,
going to be able to leave.
No, I sat sort of with my arms covered and he went, nice top.
I must say, it just made me slightly anxious when I came in there. But no, it was a lot of fun. I mean, and also the guys, their attention to detail and making sure everything was right, even in those first recordings, I was like, yeah, you guys are really something special creatively. And you've just taken that on in the script and in the kind of the working that you've done on that, and now producing a complete album. It's just so right and so perfect. And yeah, if we hadn't got a venue for the show, I think the whole thing would just burst. We just need to now, it needs to be shared with the audiences now, because they are always the kind of final ingredient in the success of a musical. You know, it's all very well everyone on stage having a great time and singing the songs and telling the story, but the audience for Eugenius and a lot of other really successful musicals, they get involved as well, and they certainly will in Eugenius.
We did a concert performance at the London Palladium, and that was a workshop, but most workshops are done sort of above a pub to about 20 people, but the you know, Warwick and the other producers that were involved were so confident in the piece that, you know, they wanted to sort of show it in a much larger scale, and you don't get much larger than than the Palladium.
Yeah.
So we did that. It was a bit of a risk because, you know, all those years of work could have gone horribly wrong within seconds, but thankfully all the reviews and the response was brilliant. So I mean, that was a long time ago now, and we've spent a long time trying to find the right theatre for the piece. And, you know, ever since I went to the other palace, which is where it's on, which is Andrew Lloyd Webber's main theatre to bring out new musicals, I knew that that was the right place for it. So it was really just a question of asking when they had availability, and thankfully they came up with it, which was good.
I got an audition just like most other people, and I didn't really know anything about it until I got my recall when I had the material. And it was when I read the scenes, and this character is just so confident, and that's the best thing about him is his confidence, and he's so unhinged, and his energy is incredible, and he's not ashamed of himself, and that's what I think is so great. There's so many characters out there who don't fit inside a box, or they class themselves very much as a geek, and he owns it, and that's what I think was so amazing. And playing, I remember I was doing my audition, just playing with the scenes, and they were like, "Yeah, just give more." And I said, like, "The further you could go with it, the more fun it was." And then it came to rehearsing, and then actually doing the show, and that's when I knew the response from the audience was just for the whole show. It was just incredible. I'd been involved in amazing productions that I've had great responses, but that, just the full palladium, just on their feet, going crazy at the end of the show, was just amazing.
Well, you've been in everything from Book of Mormon.
Yeah, I've done some amazing productions. The Book of Mormon had an amazing buzz around it. Louisville was incredible. That had this crazy, it's like a concert feel. You know, the audience don't just applaud, they scream, they shout, and they get really involved. And I remember just feeling then, this is something special. So since then, I've just been like, "Hey guys, I still exist, and I'm very interested in everything happening." So I've been
open the curtains, and he's there.
Yeah, yeah. So I did the album, which was again another amazing experience. You know, as a performer, you want to do as many things as you can, and for this show's legacy as well, you know, to be involved in that is amazing, to have the album, the concept.
Talking of the concept album, we have another star from the concept album over there. Come over.
Yeah.
We're currently starring in a musical called Flashdance, and we're on the road, and I needed to record a character within the musical called Super Hot Lady. And obviously, Joanne was the obvious choice. We actually contacted you ages ago, though, didn't we?
Well, of course they did, didn't you?
Yeah, it was pretty much at the start of the process. I'd sort of got in contact with Joe and sort of sent the music through, and obviously you had so much going on, but you said from then that I really want to get involved in this, and then you started working with Ben, and it all worked out.
It was really, really weird. I really want to do it, if you'll have me next time, please. Thank you.
Of course we will. But yeah, so we recorded all the songs now for your part and Dan's part, and the concept album is fully ready, but we've only released three tracks now, and as you said before, you know, it's available on all sort of Spotify's and iTunes and all that kind of stuff. So our choreographer is a guy called Aaron Renfrey, who he does do musical theatre stuff, but he's more known for doing pop choreography, really, so for bands like The Saturdays and that kind of stuff. And I think that was exactly what we needed for this musical, because it's a very 80s inspired musical, and most of the songs are set out with a convention that is more like a pop video, especially songs like Super Hot Lady. It's more like a sort of MTV video pop concert on stage with an amazing storyline. So we wanted to sort of incorporate that, and he did an amazing job at the Palladium. He's amazing. He's so creative.
Well, it's also his choreography. It tells a story and it's funny. I mean, it's kind of, to make choreography funny is a really difficult thing to do. But I'd seen, there were moves in there I'd never seen before. You just were brilliant, weren't they?
Yeah. I mean, it was lovely to blend all those ideas, because you don't want to be separate groups. You don't want the directors to take one approach on it and the writers to take another. And, you know, everyone worked together as a team. So not only did he come up with some fantastic dance moves that I'm sure Jo would appreciate from her background, but also, as you say, I was crying with laughter at the story that he was able to tell through the moves.
And the ensemble that they got for the choreography for Aaron to work with from Lanes, were they all from Lanes?
Yeah.
And they just did such an amazing job. They just took to it. And every time we would work kind of on different things, and they would be downstairs in a different studio, and when we were rehearsing for the Palladium, they'd come up and they'd be like, "Okay, let's run this number." We'd have done what we were doing in our room, and they'd come up and we'd all just be like,
"Yeah."
Well, it did help that the parts that they were playing was called the Fish People.
Been thinking about this a lot recently, and thinking, do I just think the 80s is the best because it was my teenage years and I have most references to that decade, or did it just produce some really cool popular culture stuff, movies, music, you know, celebrity? I think it's the latter. I think it did produce some of the best stuff. You know, there were some awful things, awful films and stuff, but many of them, and then kind of, they were so bad, they were good anyway, though. So I don't think we need to worry too much about that. But, you know, you look at the success of something like Stranger Things at the moment, which is set in that decade, and all the little callbacks, all the things we recognise from that decade in there. You know, I think it is just a brilliant sort of... I guess it's like a kind of, you would look into that decade and it's just, there's stuff you can take creatively and use.
I think there's also a massive element of imagination because it's just before that real kickoff of, you know, CGI animation. So it's like, I grew up with Ray Harryhausen, sort of watching all the puppetry work and all of the work that George Lucas was doing and sort of using the imagination. And it became the decade where anything became possible as we learned to use more techniques. And so you've got these fantastic films that hadn't existed or we didn't believe they ever could exist. And now I think we take it for granted a little bit that they're so easy to do.
I actually prefer it how it used to be back then. You know, when you see so many CGI things now, I think it actually ruins them.
Well, it's kind of going back that way with the stuff we've been doing on Star Wars recently. You know, there's a lot more use of those old techniques, you know, performers in suits and puppeteers and that sort of thing are being used more as part of the overall toolbox. You know, CG is still very much there, but all of these different techniques are used together as opposed to just going, right, now we've got CG, we're going to just do it that way, you know, because I think people do appreciate a real performance.
You've got things like Dark Crystal coming back, so the Jim Henson works all still there, which is amazing. And it's lovely to see these incredible talents being able to bring, you know, new versions of their work out and the clever sort of animators and puppeteers and all those sort of things. It's really cool.
Well, the thing about the 80s, nobody was afraid either. It was one of those kind of decades where you could just try stuff and it was never really too over the top or too big. It kind of, you got away with it. Whereas I don't think the 90s and, you know, decades that we're in now, I don't think you can quite do that anymore. And Eugenius is able to take advantage of that to the full, you know, as you mentioned earlier, you know, the soundtracks, you know, you can actually use instruments and use them in a way that you probably couldn't get away with in music currently.
Absolutely. I mean, I write and produce for all sorts of artists, you know, some of the biggest people that are in the charts right now. And I think the joy for me of writing a musical like Eugenius and the music and the way that I've produced it, is that there weren't any limitations. And I think now a lot of music and a lot of sounds, and it's all about being very cool and dark and linear. And the 80s wasn't about that. If I wanted to throw the kitchen sink in, you know, to the last chorus and put hundreds of vocals over it and do the biggest, most obtrusive snare drum, for example, or, you know, just I could, the options were limitless for me. And I think that's why it was so fun to do it. And you know, all the performers, Dan and the band and stuff like that, they have so much fun performing, not, you know, the music and the script, and that it actually is so infectious to the crowd, and I think they in turn sort of can see how much fun we're having and join in.
Hmm.